Don't ever call someone's idea crazy. You'll probably end up eating your words, or in this case, drinking them. Our guest today knew that cider was not just for crepes and galettes anymore. And when he heard the French government was paying farmers to chop down apple trees in his home region of Normandy, he knew the time was now. I'm Susan Schwartz, your drinking companion, and this is Lush Life Podcast. Every week, we are inspired to live life one cocktail at a time by the best in the industry. Xavier Dodefray and his co-founder Pierre knew they had hit on something when Colette in Paris, the store that put the concept into concept store, and Joël Robuchon, the most Michelin-starred chef in the world, were the first supporters of Maison Sassy, the cider they had produced in their hometown in Normandy. Now it was up to them to convince the rest of the world. Xavier is here to tell us how the story began.
So, like, I grew up in Normandy at the Chateau de Sassy. That's where the name Sassy, Maison Sassy, come from. And in my family, at the Chateau de Sassy, we are producing cider and Calvados since 1852. So since I'm super young, I'm used to participate at the harvest and the cider production. And it was super, like, passionate, because when I was younger, every year, you know, all my friends and family came once a year during the harvest, so from September to mid-November at the chateau for the weekend to help us to like harvest the apples. So it was very like friendly moments, and that you know I remind a lot as a very good memory. And you know, it creates a special link between like the product and me, and that's why I'm very passionate by Normandy in general, and I love like cider because of this very precious moment, family moments, and you know, it's like the Madeleine de Proust, what we call the Madeleine de Proust for me.
So when you got everyone together, how did the ritual go? You collect the apples, and then what happened?
So first it was like a big dinner or lunch, and then we were just going in the orchards with like some big baskets, and we were like a team of two, you know, a team of two, and just like picking the apples. So we don't shake the trees, for example. We wait for the apples to drop naturally when they are mature enough. So it means like we had to pick the apples on the ground. Because we have sheep in the orchard, so like it means like the sheep allow us to have this process, because we wait for the apple to drop naturally when they are mature enough, and the sheep they eat the grass, so they maintain the grass low and healthy. Like this, when the apple drop, they don't perish too quickly. So that's why we were a team of two, one with the basket and the other one picking the apple and putting in the basket.
You weren't worried that the sheep would eat the apples?
No, because during the harvest, we remove the sheep from the orchard. Yeah.
And so after you have all the apples, where did you take them? Would you take them to a special place, or did you do it in the chateau?
So we were putting the apples in what we call paddocks, in order to mature, to mature a bit like the apples. So for a week, and then we started like pressing the apples, yeah.
And then, obviously, the liquid came out of the apples.
Yeah.
And then where did you store it? And what was the process to make it cider?
So the process is like, so harvest, then we mature the apple a week in paddocks, and then we start pressing. So after the press, we are putting the juice in a tank. So it will... there will be like the fermentation will start, so it will create like what we call a chapeau brun, a brown hat. So it means like all the impurity will go on the top of the tank because of the fermentation. So then we are doing a first clarification in order to clarify the juice and to remove all the impurity. Then we put the juice in another tank where it's gonna ferment between 2 to 4 months, depending on the weather, because the hotter it is, the warmer it is, mm-hmm. the quickest go the fermentation. So between 2 to 4 months, there were the second fermentation. And depending if we wanted a cidre doux or a cidre brut. So the more fermentation you have, the drier the product will be, because you know all the
sugar is eaten.
Yeah,
right?
The sugar is eaten by bacteria, and that's what creates alcohol. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, you grew up doing this.
Yeah.
You know, it was just a ritual, a family ritual.
It was very like small volume. So we are talking about like less than 2,000 liters. So it was just to have fun, to have the family together, to have the friend together, to spend a good moment with like family and friends. And it was not a business. It was, again, we were not selling any bottles. It was just for our day-to-day consumption and for friends' consumption.
Did you grow up thinking this would be what I would do when I grew up, was to create cider? Or did you go to school for something else and then come back to it?
I always wanted to launch my own company. Like, so I'm the co-founder. Pierre-Emmanuel is the other co-founder. So he's based in France. And when, in 2000, during the dot-com bubble, we were saying to our parents, we want to launch our own startup, and we were 12 years old. So, you know, our parents, they were laughing. Go back to school, pass your exam, and then you will discuss later about creating a company. And you know, at this time, I don't think they believe like 14 years later we would actually launch our own company, but we did it, so it's amazing. So I think I had from the beginning, almost the beginning, the desire to create something, you know, to create something. I didn't knew exactly what. But it was, you know, inside me, I wanted to create something.
And so when did you think, cider? Cider may be that thing that I create.
So I'm very attached to the Norman region, passionate by apples in general and the Norman terroir. And when I studied a semester in London, my associate in Ireland, and we were super frustrated because we couldn't find the taste we like, because most of the time the cider that you can easily find is either very sweet or super dry. You have good ciders in the UK, but it's not easy to find them. So we were super frustrated not to be able like to have a good cider. So we said you know, we had this idea, you know, it's crazy, like they don't have any good ciders, like we should try to promote it. And then we went back to France. We both worked in finance. And to be honest, we were a bit bored by our jobs. So we were after our work, we were having, you know, like beers, like, I don't know, cocktails.
Because you couldn't find good cider.
Exactly. Even
really?
In France.
You always drank it. No matter where you were, you wanted cider.
In Paris, it was the same. It was very like industrial products. So we were on the terrace and we were thinking, what could we launch? And you know, we said, you know, like we can't find any good ciders. So like the ideal, you know, starts to emerge. And then I read an article in the newspaper, and they were saying, the state is giving subsidies to the farmers to destroy orchards. So for us, it was a completely like, you know, nonsense.
And were these orchards in Normandy?
In Normandy, yeah. So for us, it was a complete nonsense. And we didn't understand why. Okay, like, again, Champagne, Bordeaux, Burgundy, they are super proud of their terroir.
And also Calvados.
Yeah, Calvados. And so why in Normandy should we destroy our terroir and our know-how, you know? So this was what triggered the project. We saw, okay, there are a lot of unemployment in Orne, in Normandy. Cider business, cider industry is massive in the UK. So why not to try to reinvigorate the Norman economy and also trying to put Normandy back on the map by promoting the terroir and cider in particular?
And did you think immediately, I have to go home to do this? This?
Yeah, like...
Not just Normandy itself, but Sassy, where you grew up doing this. Was that your first, you know, thought?
Yeah, it was good also like to do like a step back from Normandy, you know, like thinking of like the project. And, you know, I can't feel better than when I am in at the chateau in Normandy. So it's really like where I grew up, where my roots are. So, you know, like it was very good to take a step back there, discuss with Pierre-Emmanuel about the project.
And what was Pierre Emmanuel doing at this time? Was he also in finance?
Yeah, also in finance, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, so not super original. And,
so you kept in touch with them all this time?
Yeah.
Right, since you're 12?
Yeah, we met when we were 3 years old in Argentan, the little city close to the chateau, where we went to school together. Mm-hmm. So we know each other since we are 3 years old. So now,
so he was part of the cider making.
Exactly.
When
every
you were
weekend,
young.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So that's why also he's super attached to Normandy, the cider in general, and Sassy too, because you know he has so many good memories with the family and with me. So
So, you know, thinking about making a cider and then actually creating one that you can bring to market are two different things.
Yeah.
How did you know what taste would be right or how to start it?
We had a clear idea. We wanted to promote Sassy as a wine, as a low ABV sparkling one, let's say. So we wanted to have very complex aromas, very delicate and refined. So we didn't want to work with like the classic apple species others were working with. And luckily enough, in my family, the apple trees we were planting was different and with much more acidity. So we wanted something like very different in order to add something also in the market. You know, if it's just to do the same that everyone is doing, there is no point. We wanted really like to promote Sassy as a low ABV sparkling wine. So to be honest, it was very difficult at the beginning because we were not expert. Like we were not like a winemaker either. Like we were producing cider, but in very small volume. So it's very different when you want to produce more quantity. So we asked different cellar master, also sommelier, in order to have their feedbacks. And at the beginning, so it took us 18 months to create the three recipes. And to be honest, at the beginning, it was a complete disaster. We were doing blind tasting. And with a panel of consumers that were representing our core target. Also, we were selecting like the best cider on the market. And we were comparing with our samples. And at the beginning, Sassy was always last.
Even after the first 18 months?
No, after the 18 months, yeah. We decided to launch when Sassy was first with the cidre, rosé, and with the poiré. We really want to be 100% sure of the quality before launching the brand. So that's why it took us 18 months. The first five blind tasting were disaster. Like our friends were saying, like, come on, you should stop. Like even, you know, it was very challenging because cider is such a small market in France. It's not very common. We are consuming cider twice a year between in January and February for crepe and galette. So our friends, they didn't understand the project. Like they were saying, you know, like it won't work. Like it's, you know, we are not drinking cider. Like it can't work. Like, so especially friends, family, they don't really believe in the project. They didn't really believe in the projects. And it was very challenging to find the right balance. Because it's a very technical product. If you are producing the way we are producing, with no, you know, added sugar, water. So it was very challenging at the beginning. But you know, I think it give you some strength And it's, you know, like, it shows your motivation. You know, if you don't listen to others, you believe in your project, in your project and products, I think after you are super strong and nothing can stop you, you know, because you are so motivated. You had so many obstacles before launching the brand. So after, you know, it's much easier for you because, you know, nothing can stop you, you know.
No, of course. Absolutely. Now, did you go into it thinking we're going to have three different types, or at first were you just, you know, we're just going to have one expression? I mean, or did they, how did they come out?
Yeah,
you know, so how did you decide on those?
We wanted to have, at least two different products with their own personality. It was very important for us to show, like, okay, with different apple species, you can have a completely different taste. Again, to show, like, it's like a wine, very artisanal product. The ingredients you are using are key if you want to produce a good products. So we wanted to have at least two. And because we started planting Geneva apple, it's a red flesh apple, we were thinking, okay, there is something interesting to do. As a like a rosé apple were not existing at that time in France, so it was quite innovative for us to launch a rosé. Poiré is very typical from Normandy, but especially from Orne, where we grew up, le Don Fronté. So it was also quite obvious we should launch poiré, and obviously also like the cider, the classic, let's say, cider was like the main product we should launch because of the awareness there is of this kind of product. So it was quite natural, you know. We had, okay, we need to launch a cider, of course. We need to launch a poiré because it's very typical from the area we are coming from.
Had you made that when you were young as well?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And the rosé, it was because we had this apple in the chateau, so it was quite, you know, and it was very innovative, like to have a rosé cider without coloring, without red fruit. Mm-hmm. So we were thinking, okay, it might be interesting to promote cider as a more fun way. And our mission is really like to change the perception of cider by promoting the Norman terroir and my family know-how. And so also the small bottles in France, it didn't exist at that time. So we were the first to launch the 33 centiliter. And also with this white, white glass with a no label look labels, we wanted really like to modernize the way people were perceiving cider and like to enhance the cider category.
All right, back to when you after the 18 months.
Yeah.
So you had this product.
Yeah.
You think it's fantastic.
Yeah.
How did you start going about either changing people's minds or getting people to try it and want to have it in their shops and restaurants?
So for us, again, we wanted to disrupt the market, so we didn't want to work with crêperie. So in France, you know, we are consuming cider in crêperie, where you have like pancakes. So for us, we wanted to elevate the category. So our first accounts were Colette, which was a super trendy concept store in Paris.
Did you just call them up and say, hi, we'd like to show you this? How did that work?
We just like popped in there with our samples, you know, and tried to discuss with someone. We discussed with Marco, which was the F&B manager of the water bar. And he loved the product. He loved also our philosophy. You know, two young Norman guy coming from Normandy who wants really like to promote their terroir and their family know-how. You know, like they were super receptive to our philosophy. So we launched the company at Colette. So
that's fantastic. That is like super.
Exactly. It was
super cool.
Way. Yeah. It was like super cool. Uh-huh. So it was a good way also to change the perception of cider, because if you see Sassy at Colette or cider at Colette, okay, finally, it's not super for all people in the countryside. You know, it can be trendy.
And what was the feedback you were getting from? from this Marco.
It was amazing. Like, you know, he was pushing a lot. Like, so it was super helpful for us. And then...
And people were drinking it.
People were drinking it. Yeah, yeah, of course. Yeah. And after a couple of weeks also, we met Joël Robuchon. So the most Michelin star chef at that time in the world. You know, we were pitching at the Publicis drugstore in the Champs-Élysées, and Joël Robuchon has his restaurants downstairs. Mm-hmm. And we saw Joël Robuchon was entering in the restaurant. So my associate and I look at each other and we think, okay, we have nothing to lose. Let's try to catch him. And the guy was so interested, so curious to hear new stories, and to try new products. So it took like half an hour. So we presented it Sassy. He loved it immediately. He called his head pastry chef global, François Benoît. They all love the products, so they started working with us. For example, they did a apple chocolate granité, and it was served with a glass of poiré as a food pairing in the dessert menu. And he was saying, you know, my consumer, they are used to drink very good wines with their lunch or dinner, but they have it every day, everywhere. For me, it's all about innovation. Innovative and, you know, try to shake, you know, my consumer. Like, if I'm pushing, like, if I'm promoting a good wine with cheese, my consumer, they have it every day. But if I'm promoting cider and cheese, it's working super well. And like this, my consumer will remind the experience much longer because it's innovative. And he will remind, okay, I had an amazing pairing at a Robuchon restaurant. It was cider and Calvados. It was amazing experience. Cider and cheese, sorry. It was an amazing experience. So that's why also, like, it was very interesting for him. So we started with Colette, with Robuchon. So we had
the top of the top.
The trendiest concept store in France, plus the most Michelin star chef in the world. And after, you know, we started like discussing with 5-star hotels like Four Seasons, Shangri-La, Plaza Athénée, a lot of
palace. Always in France though.
Yeah, always in France. At the beginning we were focusing in France. We were the two of us, only Pierre-Emmanuel and I, so, you know, like, and we were just focusing on top-end markets. So a lot of, like I said, Michelin star restaurant. We are working a lot with Alain Ducasse. So we are at the Plaza Athénée in his 3 Michelin star restaurant. They are doing also food pairing, and they are also including Sassy in their recipes. For example, Jessica Preapalto, the head pastry chef of the Plaza Athénée, she did a dessert with Sassy. She dehydrated an apple and rehydrated the apple with the Sassy.
Oh my God, it sounds delicious.
Yeah. So there is a lot of way, like there is a food pairing. So for example, the cider is going very well with white meat, cheese. Mm-hmm. The poiré is going very well with seafood, fish, chocolate dessert. And the poiré is going super well with dessert and sorbets. And as an aperitif too. So for us, it's really like, we really want to promote Sassy again as a low ABV sparkling wine, as a food pairing, and to disrupt the market. We don't want to be, you know, to be on top in pubs like everyone. We want to promote the cider category in different way. And we are also pushing a lot like cocktails.
Okay, so that was going to be my next question. Okay. Was the first time I had Sassy was in a cocktail.
Yeah.
Did you ever think when you were creating it that not only will be people drinking it with food and drinking it by itself, but there may be this possibility to have a whole different crowd drinking it in a cocktail.
Yeah. So we like for the Michelin star chef, we wanted to promote the category. So we were loving like going to cocktail bars like Experimental in Paris, etc. And we were frustrated not to be able to find cider again. So for us, it was also a good way as a Michelin star chef. You know, I think now bartenders, they are are ambassadors, you know, like it's like an open kitchen. And if you see Tony at Niger having like working on a cocktail with a bottle of Sassy, for people it's quite strong, because it means, okay, if Niger is using Sassy, it's a good product. If Alain Ducasse, Joël Robuchon are working with Sassy, it means it's a good product. So we are seeing those guys are as our ambassadors, and for us it's such an honor to be able to work with this kind of people. So it's super, super rewarding for us, because we worked a lot on the recipes, as I told you. So it's super rewarding to work with the best Michelin star chef in the world, the best hotels and the best cocktail bars. And cocktail bars, for us, you know, we like, for example, we loved like spritzes, but you know why, you know, you should try maybe with a cider. We are in France, we should be proud of our terroir. So why you could easily replace a Prosecco by a cider, for example. So it was just natural, you know, like we wanted just to promote the cider category a different way. And like cocktails was a very good way to change the perception of the product.
Now, I also see that you work with some fashion icons, like the late Karl Lagerfeld. How did that come about?
So as we started at Colette, you know,
of course,
we had this cool image in the fashion industry in Paris. So during the Fashion Week, we started at the Alexander Wang showroom. So during the Fashion Week, he was serving some bottle of Sassy to their best consumers.
When did you find out that that was going to happen?
I think almost at the really beginning, like we launched the company October, November, and the Fashion Week, I don't remember, but it was almost immediate. So after, you know, like, it's like what we call in France, effet boule de neige, you know, when you have Colette, Alexander Wang, then you are contacted by other companies. So after we started working with Carven, Karl Lagerfeld. So, and for us, again, it was a good way to change the perception of the cider category and to modernize the category, because in France, it's super like old fashioned, countryside beverage.
So hopefully you've shown everyone, you know, who said, no, you can't do it, or this is a bad idea, that, you know, it can be a huge success.
Exactly, yeah. And also cider is a super modern product. Like, it's gluten-free, 100% natural. The way we are, Sassy is producing, because some people, they are adding a lot of chemicals, but Sassy is gluten-free, 100% natural, low in calories because it's only fruit inside. So like, for example, a small bottle is around 100 calories. So it's quite, you know, it's completely in the trend, but people, I don't know why, they have this perception, okay, cider is for, you know, the old people in Normandy, in the countryside. Actually, it's completely in the trend, and like, we should, like, again, it's our mission to promote it a different way.
Well, now I've got to have some. So should we go open a bottle?
Definitely. Let's go.
Cool.
Before Xavier and I parted, I asked him where Maison Sassy could be found in the UK.
Like, we launched the company in France in November 2014, and in the UK in like November 2016. So for us, UK was a super important market, because like you have the reflex of consuming cider. So it was very important for us to develop this market. And so we launched November 2016, and we started working with Niger at the beginning. It was like the first cocktail bar we worked with in the UK. And we want to just develop the market the same way we did in France. So by targeting top end venues. So we are now working with Dorchester, Rosewood Hotel, with Scarce Bar, Sexy Fish, Soho House Group. So again, the idea is to do exactly the same. And we are also like now in 15 countries. So in Japan, Australia, South Korea, Hong Kong, Canada. But even if we want to do a huge focus on France and UK. And your question was where you can consume Sassy. Like I said, Niger, we just have, we are on the new menu of Brown Hotel, Donovan Bar.
Well, how about if someone wants to just buy a bottle and not have it in a cocktail?
So you can find us at Selfridges, Harvey Nichols, Grocery Shoreditch. some wine merchants like Nysa or Pascal in Chelsea. At the moment, we really want to focus on trade. So more than off trade, but it's going to come.
Thanks so much to Xavier for explaining that. And now there's no excuse for not trying Maison Sassy, even if you think you're not a cider drinker. It might convert you. Our cocktail of the week might also convert you to Negronis, even if it's not your first choice at the bar. As we are in the midst of Negroni Week, we chose the Maison Sassy Rosé Negroni as our cocktail of the week. Build all the ingredients in a glass over ice. 30 ml of red vermouth, 30 ml of Campari, and 30 ml of Maison Sassy Rosé Cider. Then stir. Finish it off with an orange zest to garnish. It's super easy for summer. You'll find this recipe and all the cocktails of the week at alushlifemanual.com, where you'll also find all the ingredients in our shop. Next time, we head back to a very hot and sticky Charleston, South Carolina, to meet a few people who, along with Scott Blackwell of High Wire Distillery, who you met a few weeks ago on Lush Life, are making the cocktail scene there pop. Until next time, bottoms up. Thanks for listening to the Lush Life podcast. For more information and links to everything you've heard, plus a whole lot more, please visit alushlifemanual.com. Always remember the wise words of Oscar Wilde: all things in moderation, including moderation. And always drink responsibly. Okay, I said that last part. Theme music is by Steven Shapiro and used with permission. Lush Life is produced by Evo Terra. And I'm your drinking partner, Susan Schwartz. I'll see you at the bar.